moça do corpo dourado do sol de Ipanema. O seu balançado é mais que um poema. É a coisa mais linda que eu já vi passar.
Obrigada por esta oportunidade. Il vous perde, Flavia, é a melhor. That may not have sounded like Portuguese, that may have sounded more like pork and cheese. My point is, first of all, the drink is already under her chair. However,
it's a better place for the drink, I agree.
Anybody like Christmas pantomime? Let's get this over with. Can I hear a big boo directed at me? Boo! Can I hear a self-righteous, you tell him, girlfriend? Good, and now that we've gotten that out of the way, let's have a proper discussion. Because I am tired of signal virtualing. In other words, I'm gonna text this because it's so right on. I'm gonna say this because it's so right on. But instead of making a placard, instead of getting on the bus and doing anything about these issues, I'm gonna try and go viral because that'll change the world. Now the questions today are not my questions. They're going to be short questions because I have a very unfair advantage. Not only have I taken an excess of the world's resources, not only as a white male do I get to play the game of life with these settings on easy, but I'm also a man, and so, well, a boy. A scared boy. So these questions are going to be from members of my family, and I have a wonderfully diverse family that includes transsexuals, homosexuals, indigenous people, and in Canada, that's our third world, and it's tragic that it's on our doorstep. And they're not necessarily excited about seeing men go away, because they're worried that it'll be different people, same crap, if other people take over. So with all of that admittedly long introduction, let's be honest, there has been awful sexism. Atrocious. The question is whether there still is. And maybe there still is, but I would point out, in the Western world, to the best of my knowledge, there isn't a single country that doesn't have a majority of female medical school enrollees. Right on. You tell them, girlfriend. And that's a good thing. But then the accusations get a bit trickier. Now, I think this is something Flavia and I agree on entirely, and I would encourage you to take this home with you. My daughter gave me this, the Bechdel test. In Hollywood, they challenge movies on whether there are at least two women. Do they actually talk to each other or just to men? And do they talk about something other than a man? And you know what? Start challenging conferences on the Bechdel test. Start challenging your own rounds on the Bechdel test. Now we're getting somewhere. My bigger issue, though, is do the 1% women, do wealthy women need the help? Because as I say, I come from a family where a member of my family thinks this whole idea of men and women, I don't mean men versus women, I mean the entities don't even exist, and it's a convenient excuse. So let's have a chat, because everybody else says don't go there. My dear Flavia, are men sexist?
Well, can we go back to the Bechdel test, Peter? Yeah, I think I'm a scientist, as you know, so I created a modified Bechdel test. Can you agree with my test? A conference, a panel with 5 talks, and you have to search for 2 women, and none can be a pediatrician. That sounds good for you? Yeah? Okay.
Flavia, my understanding is...
I submitted the last available critical care conference to the test. And do you believe it was the Brussels meeting, by the way? Just a coincidence. And it passed. Can you believe it passed? There was a panel with two women. And I said, that's not a good test. It lacks specificity. It's a false positive. And then I created another indicator. It's the percentage of all male panel. Peter, do you know what is the percentage of all male panel in the last Brussels meeting?
Can I guess?
Yes.
Is it like the score between Brazil and Germany, 7-1?
That is not fair.
No, I do want to know the ratio.
It is counting or not the moderators. Not counting the moderators, 72%. Counting the moderators, 65%. Do you think this is sexist or not?
I believe that is sexist.
Yeah.
Will it be any different in the future if women take over?
I think they are changing. When you look at, for instance...
I'm agreeing with you, Flavia. That's my point.
This is better than the last year, at least. We had lots of young talent women this year in Brussels, actually.
I feel I'm not very sympathetic. Keep talking. Keep going, Flavia.
Actually, they are better. For instance, the European conference now, the last advertised they showed featured speakers. And more, there were, I think, 40% of women. So the European society, it's improving. I think that everyone is improving. And do you know which is the only conference with 0% of all male panel? No?
Scott Weingartz.
Smack!
Hey.
So I think that we have a lot of sexism in panels, conferences, task force. Everywhere, Peter. We can spend the whole 15 minutes just with examples, if you want.
No, I appreciate that enormously. And so that will all change as the majority female medical school enrollees become the majority of graduates, I presume, and equality will be achieved?
I'm not sure, because we have already examples of this. For instance, in the United States, 46% of the residents are females in the medical school. 38% of the medical faculty are females, but only 81% of the full professor are female, and only 14% of the chief departments are females. So I'm not sure. If you don't make a female-friendly environment, if you don't give females opportunities, if you don't mentor them, if you don't make opportunities for the females not leave their jobs, this will not improve. I think this is improving, but this will not improve. And guess something, I think that here, we from the middle-income countries, we have a sort of advantage. The inequality in the middle-income countries give us a sort of advantage, because for my whole career, I could pay for a maid, I could pay for a nanny, so I could dedicate myself during the daytime more to my job. And this is a sort of nonsense thing that the inequality gives to us. So in Brazil, it is different. I was in a meeting in my own faculty, and the dean of the university, the dean of the campus, the dean of the medical faculty, and the dean of the department were all females. Yeah. This is different.
That is different. You made a very good point about creating a culture and an environment that's more welcoming. Last night, a few people told me that I was overly deferential to my last interrogee. I was too kind to him. And so I said, well, I'll be really mean to the next one. And they said, you definitely can't be. You should be even nicer. That sounds patronizing, and that sounds like a double standard that is unfair to the women in intensive care.
I don't think that we need to be patronized. This is a behavior that they value women. We don't need to be patronized. We need to be treated as equals. We are just equals. But if there is a systematic, explicit, and implicit bias against women, then this is not treating us as equals. And there is, so we have to change this.
Fantastic, thank you. We're going to talk about lower middle income countries. As I say, they exist in all countries. They exist in Canada to our utter shame. The United Nations suggests that all nations should give about 1% of GDP to charity. What percentage of this audience do you think gives 1% to charity?
I don't know. It depends on what you call charity. Time that you give for social activities counts as charity. Or if you deliver some of your time in the work to do things that you don't receive payment for, this is charity. So I would say 100%.
That's because you're trying to win this debate, isn't it? Yeah, go sister. Because I think so many people rely on governments to do their charity for them. So tell me about what the rest of the critical care world needs to know to do, most importantly, to be more of a partner to lower and middle income countries.
I think that it's a little bit the same thing that we are talking and discussing about the female thing. We don't need to be patronized by the high income countries. And we just need the opportunity. I mean, we just need, of course, we need also help. Yeah, but we don't need to be patronized. We need opportunities, and we need to be inserted in all the discussions about what is going on. And I think, for instance, the Sepsis Task Force, it's a great example of what is not including low and middle income countries in a discussion that it's all related what's happened with us as well. So not patronizing, but giving opportunity.
Is a lot of the help that we currently offer probably more imperialism? Do it like we do. We'll take what we want. You can partner with us, but when it suits us?
Yeah, I think. I think that there are better ways of doing this. For instance, training us is a good thing to do. And getting us, inserting us in the research opportunities that we have all around the world. I can't think in a single way to get an ICU better than getting this ICU in a research program, for instance. You can get an ICU giving much more better care if you insert this ICU in a research program. So, for instance, getting us doing things together with the other research networks that exist in the world can help us. Training our multidisciplinary teams, offering us fellowships in the high-income countries. There are other ways to help us.
Thank you. If the biggest determinants are actually more things like good government and strong sanitation rather than good critical care, does evidence-based critical care become more important or less important when resources are limited?
I think that you mean if critical care is more important in the low and middle income countries than in the high income countries? That is what you mean?
I mean the evidence. Is it a luxury for the first world?
Using evidence-based, certainly. It's certainly more important when you are in a very resource-limiting settings, because if you don't have the resource, you have to know how to use them better. There are lots of examples of this. For instance, using a quality improvement based on what is already known by the literature, it's fundamental. I can give you many examples of this. For instance, in our own ICU, when we have the results of the dexmedetomidine trial, we just stopped using. We not always have dex in our ICU, but after the results of that trial, we said we are only going to use dex with this indication. So using medicine, using evidence-based medicine, using this, it's fundamental. The safe trial, it has two different meanings in Australia and for us in Brazil. In Australia, it's saying it is safe to use albumin. In Brazil, it is saying it can be safe, but it makes no difference, so we are not going to use them because it's cheaper to use saline.
Fantastic. Guys, I hope in a year and a half's time when we're all next at SMAC, all 2,700 of us are wearing that I am a feminist t-shirt, or we're wearing I actually have done something for the first world, third world, rather than just, well, I do plenty of things, rather than just signal virtue. So I thank Flavia enormously. I'm going to ask you through cartoon cheers or jeers, do we need to actively end, or will it die on its own, actively end medicine's bias towards first world white men? If the answer is yes, cheer it out.
So it's mine. Thank you, Peter.
If anyone else would like to cheer for the opposing motion, I'm not going to allow it. Thank you, my dear.
Thank you.